from Poland to Peru and Burma to Beijing. We owe the Minister of Open gratitude because he reminded us that the desire for democracy and human rights are shared by everyone, because each person is endowed by freedom and inalienable rights. The Chinese Communist Party has tried to curtail his ideas. They call them dangerous and subversive, and they seek to silence, censor, and repress them. Yet they live on in the hearts of untold millions of Chinese people. The Liu Xiaobo's death is also reminded of the words of Dr. Martin Luther King, who said, "Injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere." We should all agree that what was done to Liu Xiaobo and his wife, Xia, was a grave injustice. Liu Xiaobo's imprisonment in 2009 became a death sentence. The blame for this should lie squarely on the Chinese government, and for his death, they alone should be held accountable. Liu Xiaobo was the first Nobel Peace Prize winner to die in state custody since Karl von Ossietzky died after being held in a Nazi concentration camp. 2 days ago, we heard the Chinese government complaining that it was stabbed in the back by those expecting it to deal quickly with its client state in North Korea. How shameful it is to play the victim card while the victim of their own repression lay down. No nation should be judged entirely by crimes of the past, but this crime, the death and silencing of Liu Xiaobo, should follow the Chinese Communist Party like a Washington permanent standard. We must never forget Liu Xiaobo's enduring contributions, whether during the Tiananmen massacre, where he helped save the lives of many students, or with Charter 08, the treaties urging political and legal reforms in China based on constitutional principles. We must not forget Liu Xiaobo. We must advance and preserve his legacy and repeatedly confront the Chinese Communist Party with his ideas and his memory. In this time of need, we must signal the Congress's unanimous support for Liu Xiaobo's family, his wife Xia, and all those bravely standing up for human rights in China. I was invited by Liu Xiaobo's family to attend the 2010 Nobel Peace Prize ceremony. It's a moving ceremony, the now famous empty chair, a photograph of that over on my right, speaks volumes of the Chinese Communist Party's abiding fear that human rights and democracy will undermine its power. I will always remember the words of Liu Xiaobo's speech that day, of course, I'm not kidding, it's impossible, about the importance of oppressive human rights. Freedom of expression, he said, is the foundation of human rights, the source of humanity. Mother truth. To strangle freedom of speech is to trample on human rights, stifle humanity, and suppress truth. He also expressed his hopes for China's future. He said, "I firmly believe that China's political progress will not stop. And I, if Xiaobo, filled with optimism, look forward to the advent of a future free China. For there is no force that can put an end to the human quest for freedom, and China will be, in the end, will become a nation worldwide law where human rights reign supreme." Liu Xiaobo will sadly go to sea in free China. Chinese authorities have gone to great lengths to stifle his ideas and those who follow him. In recent years, the government of President Xi Jinping has engaged in an extraordinary assault on the rule of law, human rights, ethnic minority groups, and civil society. As China's economic and military power grows, more and more countries will be afraid to raise subjects Chinese Communist Party wants to make taboo. The U.S. stands alone, inadequate as its efforts are at times, in its willingness to keep on raising human rights issues that need to be raised. The U.S. cannot lightly shrug off the mantle of being a democracy defender, no matter how heavy that mantle may become. It is tempting to be pessimistic about China's future and the future of U.S.-China relations, but I'm not pessimistic, and taking a cue from Liu Xiaobo, none of us should be. Constant repression does not dim the desires for the Chinese people for freedom and reform, and of course that's attributed to the great work of Liu Xiaobo. Nevertheless, the U.S. cannot be morally neutral or silent in the face of the Chinese government's repression of fundamental freedoms. Human rights is not a secondary interest, but one critically linked to all issues in China, including U.S. economic and security issues. The U.S. does not shy away from meeting with China's other Nobel Dalai Lama or other dissidents. We must use congressional congressionally authorized sanctions to hold Chinese officials accountable for torture and gross abuses, including those prescribed in the International Religious Freedom Act and, of course, the Global Magnitsky Act. We must connect internet and press freedoms as both economic and human rights priorities, and we must demand repeatedly and clearly that unconditional release of political prisoners is in the interest of a better U.S.-China relationship. I believe that someday China will be free. Someday the people of China will be able to enjoy all of their God-given rights, and a nation of free Chinese women and men will honor and celebrate Liu Xiaobo as a hero who will be honored along with others like him who have sacrificed so much and for so long for freedom. I yield to my distinguished.
Joining us today. I extend my condolences to Liu Xiaobo's family and friends on his recent passing. Chairman Smith, we've long been a champion, as demonstrated by her actions over the years and today. The loss of Liu Xiaobo has once again brought attention to the issues of human rights in China. Tragically, his imprisonment and passing is a reminder of the importance of monarchy and the treatment of those who have been in prison or who have lost their lives fighting for freedom. Freedoms like the freedom of religion,